this special is fun. She should be very proud and relieved. I know that'll last for like 5 minutes.
I mean, you've done so much, but having that hour is such a feather in a comedian's cap.
Yes. I mean, a lot of this is for oneself. You know, and if I can write a various jokes about shitting my pants, then, you know.
You did it. You did it.
Good to see you, Nick.
Hi.
Oh, my God. It's Nick Kroll.
Is that a great way to get this show going? Hey, guys. How are you?
Sure is.
It sure is. So you got your special. It's very exciting, but we don't, you know, we're not this kind of show normally, but we have to ask, because you're in that new Olivia Wilde movie, why did you spit on Chris Pine?
Yeah, Nick.
You know, just trying to keep up with the times. I think that's it was. I think it was a TikTok challenge, is what I was told. I was told by a small Italian street urchin that for relevance that I should do that, and I went back to check with the child after the premiere, and he was gone. Oh, I don't know if he ever existed at all.
All kidding aside, you look. Like a movie star, Nick, when you're out there on the big red carpet in your cool suit, you look like you belong. Yeah. It's not like when you see comedians sometimes appear places where we shouldn't be. you look legit.
I passed?
100%.
Your suit was really cool. I loved your suit.
It was.
Thank you. I'm going to be honest with you guys, because I know that this is this kind of show. Let's talk fashion. You know, you get someone puts you in clothing for things like this. Because that's not something I'm like, I'll just pick out that bright blue Dolce & Gabbana tuxedo. That's just in the closet. That's always just lying around in the closet ready to go.
This old thing.
And this old thing. And so like 2 days before I was supposed to, I was like, should I wear something else? You know, and it was just sort of, you know. But it's when in, as they famously say, when in Venice.
That's the famous thing.
Was it cool? What is that experience like? Is it a fun thing to do?
I had a blast. Yeah. I had a real blast. Like, you know, I think for comics, you know, it's weird. Like, because I think, I don't know about you guys, but, you know, comics, we all want to be funny. And we want to, obviously, that's what we do. It's what's paid our bills. It's how we've lived and navigated the world. Yeah. But like, there's a part of us that also like, it's like, it might be fun to be a movie star. You know what I mean?
Yeah. So,
you know, it might be, I mean, that also might be okay. So then you get put in that situation and it's all of a sudden, it's not exactly your world. It's not what we know. And I had been through versions of that. I've been in a couple other things. Like I was at Cannes a few years ago. And so I was like slightly prepared for how truly bizarre it was, and what ultimately helped was before I got on the red carpet, and then when I got on the red carpet, I turned the camera on them. I started filming the process, and like once that's sort of what we do is we need to be able to comment on what's happening or turn the tables a little bit, and then it becomes a little less scary and a little less intimidating.
Yeah,
and the truth is, you know, obviously there's all this. I don't know if you guys heard, but there's been some drama around the film.
Just a little.
But for me, I had such a blast making the film with all of those people. And some of them I hadn't seen since we shot it. And so it was just fun to see people who I genuinely enjoyed working with and became friends with. And so then all of a sudden you're seeing them for the first time in a year or whatever. Happens to be on the red carpet in front of the world. It's a bit of a dream.
Yeah.
So it's like if you don't take it too seriously, it's just hilarious and very fun.
I was on a plane last night with Shia LaBeouf. I should have been like, hey, what's up, dude? What's going on?
And you guys are no longer seeing each other. Is that right?
Me and Shia? No, we broke up. It was awkward.
What's the scoop? We thought we were getting the scoop on Nick Kroll, you know, in a blue tuxedo at the Venice Film Festival. The truth is, we're getting the inside scoop on Fortune
and
her former flame. Fortune Feimster's former flame, Shia LaBeouf, on a plane together.
Very exciting. But Nick, congratulations on Little Big Boy, your new special here on the Netflixes. It's great.
Is that how it's referred to? Is the Netflixes? Is that how you're now referring to the
Netflix? You know, Zoom's crashing. There's a lot of things going on. But sincerely, I'll give you just a moment of sincerity. Mm-hmm. It's really, really good. It was so fun to watch. It felt to me like a culmination of all the fun things that you do. Like the mm-hmm. writing is so great. Your voices and your embodying, like acting out the bits, was so good. It looked great. It was relevant. It was like literally. We don't go on like this about everybody's specials. It was really, really well done. Really.
Yeah, we bring people on here to tell them they suck. So you're a lucky one.
Yeah, we'll just kind of skip over some stuff. But really, Nick, congratulations. It's not an easy thing to pull off.
Thank you. Well, you know, I've come on this show a few times, and it's always a pleasure talking to you. But I have real respect for both of you guys. It's usually to talk about something else, you know, Big Mouth or something else. So to talk to you guys about stand-up from two true craftsmen, that's nice of you to say. Stand-up has always been something I've done, but more of like as I've, like, you know, it's like I always had 20. I got 20. Right. I can go anywhere. I got 20, you know, and it was felt like it was time to kind of be like, no, I want to show I can do I got an hour and it's a good hour. And I want to put it out there and be like, this is my foray into that. And as much as I've always done it and feel very comfortable as a stand up, there is something slightly, honestly, we're talking about, you know, like being in Venice or whatever. There's something even slightly very vulnerable making about shooting the special.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
You know, because a spot is a spot. You bomb, you're done. Who cares? You go home. Fuck that audience that night.
Right.
Or, you know, oh shit, Papa saw me bomb at the store, or Fortune won't talk to me because she and Shy are back together. Whatever it is. But, you know, you put out you tour it, and then you shoot the special, and then you hope you got it.
Yeah.
And then you hope it cuts together. And then it's out of your hands, and it's you're like, this is the best that I could do. You know what I mean? And that's a kind of a scary, that feels very vulnerable.
Was it very vulnerable too, because you were you versus, like, you know, your characters? Did you find the process to be a lot different?
I think so. I think that, you know, when, you know, I've always done stand up, but I've always done so much of the character stuff that it's easier to hide behind the characters, you know, and then, you know, after doing Big Mouth, I think I found I was so rewarded for being more vulnerable, being more transparent about my life, about who I am. And it felt like I tried to take that lesson into the stand-up, where I was sort of like, well, let's be more honest. You know, and I mean, obviously I'm doing all the voices and stuff, but ultimately I'm kind of telling my story inside of it. And that's, you know, that's a little... that's scarier, you know. Mm-hmm. You can't hide behind the character's point of view. You can't hide behind the voice as much, and so I was sort of like, all right, if, you know, because the stand-ups that I love and the hours that I love, you really do feel like you're learning about people. You're really learning about their lives, and they're sharing. They're not, you know.
Yeah.
They're letting you in.
Yeah.
In some way, and that's. Frankly, can be very vulnerable making.
But that's, you know? what was really so cool about this one is you have all these other things, all these very funny pieces of your career that people watch, and you have this really great fan base, and then to see you kind of like poke out from behind it and still have all the shades, of course, because you're talking about being a kid and not saying I love you until you're 32 and like all this kind of vulnerable stuff, all of your work still is like this reflection of you, and then seeing you pop out as really yourself, it's gonna be great for your fans to see.
Thank you.
How did you decide on that suit?
It was a suit that I had worn before. I did Carnegie and wore it at Carnegie and thought it looked good there. But honestly, it was, frankly, I don't know how you guys felt with that stuff. Like, you know, when you shoot something, the special, I'd been working on the material. I had really just been working on touring, but I was doing a bunch of other stuff. And all of a sudden, it was like the week of the special. And I was like,
yeah.
Oh, I haven't thought about this. Like, you know, like, I don't know if people understand, but when you're making these specials, it's like you've got a producer, but much more than in other things. It's really, you are producing this thing because you've been, you're, it's like, it's, you know, I did it in, shot at the Warner in DC, and it was a great theater. It's, in a way, it's like any other tour date.
Yeah.
It just happens that there's like six cameras of filling a theater, and you're like, I was all of a sudden like, oh shit, like I didn't have a t-shirt until an hour before. I bought sneakers that day. Like it just, what I was wearing was secondary. I just, it just didn't like, you know, but you know, it was,
it looked great.
It was, I was, thank you. I was wearing some version of that, like a suit and a t-shirt on the whole tour.
Yeah.
But I just didn't, it was weirdly, like literally I was trying on t-shirts like 45 minutes before the show.
That's because your dad kept you now. Loose.
Yeah,
it probably kept you loose.
Me honest.
Yeah,
and it is when you become a parent, you know, and you're trying to do all this stuff. Like, in a on its on, if you're lucky enough to be busy with whether it's personal life, family, or with work, it doesn't let you think too much about the stuff that doesn't matter.
Right.
Just anything besides the act. You know what I mean? Like,
yeah.
And you have to, or at least for me, that was the case where I was like, all right, well, this is what I, you know, I don't know. I'm not going to think too much about how I look or what I'm wearing. I just need to like, if it's the hours there, then the hours there.
Yeah. How was the tour leading up to it? Was it challenging balancing everything?
It was, you know, the whole, so I basically like around 2018, it was about four years ago. My then girlfriend, my now wife, we were away, and she was sort of like, hey, how come you haven't done an hour? I said, well, I did an hour in like 2012. I did this hybrid hour for Comedy Central. You know, it was more characters and stand up, but it had been well over a decade. And I was like, you know, that's for Mulaney. It's for Ali Wong. It's for like, for my buddies who are like, they're stand ups. Like, they do other stuff, but they're stand ups. That's what they do. I was like, I'm not, I do stand up, as I said, like, I do it as like, I got my 20 and she was like, okay, but I've seen you do stand-up. You seem like you like it and you're, you know, good. I was like, yeah, it's not for me. It's just, I don't do the hour. And then I kept sort of being like, why haven't I done the hour? Why don't I do it? And I think I was sort of like, again, it's am I ready to be more open and vulnerable? Do I want to put myself out there? Do you want to put out the hour and be like, fuck, it doesn't measure up?
Yeah.
You know, there's a fear there. If just doing spots and you're like, you're doing well at the store, you're at Largo, or you're at the Cellar, you're on the road doing, you're like, I did fine tonight, it was fun, but there's that fear of like, what if I put out the hour and it just doesn't, it's not as good as everybody else's. And I sort of, you know, I think I kept thinking about it, and then I took it as a challenge. And so beginning of 2019, I started to assemble, you know, all the 20 minutes that I've had over time, and then, you know, put the tour together for the second half of 2019. And by the end of 2019, had toured the country and gone to, you know, London and Australia and New Zealand, and was like, all right, let's go. And I booked DC for June 2020.
Mm-hmm.
Perfect.
I don't know if you guys remember.
Perfect.
The top
those times.
Yeah. So all of a sudden I, you know, everything stopped, including the tour and then including the special. And then life took over, and you know, the tour was called Middle Aged Boy.
Mm-hmm.
And it's about, am I a man or a boy? You know, where am I? I was 40, 41. I was still, at that point, I wasn't married. I you know, I was sort of in this, like, what am I at this point?
Yeah.
And then life kind of took over, and I got married and had a kid. And so it, in a weird way, the third act of the special kind of appeared for my real life. And then when the world started to open up, I started to go out and do the spots again. And, you know, at first just like, you know, supernova, whatever, these LA outdoor spots, and started to be like, what is the hour now? What's the new material? What's coming out? As you guys know, when you build the hour, it's like, all right, I have an hour. Mm-hmm. And then you're like, 25 minutes of it is garbage. Can I keep beating that 25 minutes and slowly pushing the garbage out, and then reorganizing and doing all the stuff that, as you guys know, you have to fall in love with the polish and the edit to really make it all make sense. And so I started doing that. And then as the world opened up, I would start to pop out and do, you know, a few more dates in Chicago, a few more, you know, and then finally open back up before, between some jobs crunched in like Texas and Phoenix and, you know, a few other spots to just start, just run whatever I thought the hour was going to be before DC and got it done. So it was all in about a 3-year process with, you know, that massive COVID gap side of it that ended up being so much of the life that then gets put inside of the special.
It's so good. It really worked out. Like, that timing really worked out because it's such a full story. You're so good about mining your childhood, but then to like have that third act be about your where you are now and your child, you talking about your slicing off the cheeks of your baby just because it's so cute. Like, you really feel it. It's so great. It really is so good. It would be totally different experience if you didn't have that chapter of the special.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and I had a minute where, you know, I had this, the special ended at a place, it's really between us when people hopefully watch it or hear it, they'll know, but like, you know, it ended in Italy. And there's a world where I could have ended it there and then be like, and now I've got the next 20 for the next thing. But it just didn't feel, you know, that feeling of like, you want it to, what's interesting now is the stuff that's happening now. You don't want to I don't want to save this. It's like, it's got to go together.
Yeah.
But it's scary when you I don't know how you guys feel when you finish the hour and then you're like, all right, now, fuck, does it start over?
That's where I'm at right now.
Are you going out? Are you doing spots? Are you out in the world yet?
I just finished filming for 5 months, so I had to kind of put it to the side. So I'm about to start going to clubs and stuff in LA.
Is this the Schwarzenegger? Can I ask?
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
How was it?
Amazing.
Fortune's an action star now.
Don't I know it? Fortune didn't need to be in that show to know that for me to know that she's an action star.
That's right.
Star.
I carry my guns. Action star like a badge of honor. My swagger.
Yeah. Oh, don't I know it?
But yeah, I'll be hitting the Comedy Store and the Improv and all those places soon enough.
And it's weird because you do this thing and you're like, all right, well, I'll put out the special, and then it's like, and then I'll capitalize on the special coming out, but then you're like, with what?
Right.
Right. You know?
Yeah.
I got nothing. You know, I got the 10 minutes that I cut out of the special. You know, like, can I do that? Do you ever repeat? Like, once it's in the special, is it done? Is it to bed, gone, never to be said out loud again?
I talked with Nate Brigazzi about that. He's like, there are jokes that people want to hear and, you know, do your new stuff, but also don't shy away from some of those, you know, quote unquote classics.
Yeah. If you want to do a good show, it's virtually impossible unless you just disappear for a while. So, you know, and your fans are coming out to see it. They do want to see it live. They want to be in the room with like a favorite bit that you're doing. You know, you can't be lazy about it and just say, I'm just going to keep doing this. But
can I do other people's material?
That's what I would like to.
That would be cool. We should do a swap.
Can we just do covers? Can I do some covers?
Why not? Yeah. It's your show.
Right. I just do dice. Yeah, do whatever. I just do dice from 89.
Please.
Where are you at with your shows?
Big Mouth. I think it was announced October and October 28th. Big Mouth comes out.
What season is that?
Season 6 will be airing.
Wow.
And then
we've
been writing. I think it's. I don't know what's been announced. I don't know.
Yeah.
Someone can. I think big, you know, Netflix. Well, you guys
more's
got
coming.
Inside scoop. We got one more coming. Human Resources comes out, and season 2 comes out. I think in the spring probably, and then History of the World Part 2. For Hulu, which I don't know if I can mention on Netflix's a joke radio.
We'll let you.
We're friendly. We're friendly.
Thank you. That'll come out. I don't know when that announcement's coming out. So that's what I was working on before the special. So it's like, you know, it's that thing when you're like, I'm very fortunate that I get to do various things, but it also means there are times where you're like, you're doing the thing that you're supposed to do every day, like this, you know, making History of the World, and then it's like, all right, now like go and shoot the special, mm-hmm. and you're like, oh, yeah. maybe I should not do these things all at once. Maybe I should, but. Yeah. But I don't know. You have that appetite. Mm-hmm. We just, I don't know how you guys feel, but it's just like, you just, you know, there's, when you're a performer, there's a, no matter how good things are, there's always the feeling of scarcity.
Mm-hmm. And yes.
You never want to, like, I don't have the confidence to just, like, yeah. sit back and only do the one thing. Like, I'm like, no, I have to do this and this and this. Because I'm worried that if I don't, it'll all go away, or I won't have the opportunity right. to do it again, you know?
Yeah.
Yeah. It's like our careers are fueled by fear.
Yes. For real. Yeah.
I know.
It's almost as if we weren't brimming with confidence as children.
Yeah, exactly. So where are you now? Do you feel like you're in a good space? Like, do you feel like you got to... I guess you're still juggling
slowed down a bit. I feel so fortunate to do what I get to do. I mean, mm-hmm. I was in a club right the night before the special. I wanted to run it one more time in DC at this little kind of underground club. And I was looking at the wall of headshots of the folks who were, I think, the regulars there. Uh-huh. And I was like, boy, some of these folks are so excited to be on the wall of this club that they got their headshot on this wall. Yeah. And it just filled me with gratitude that I get to do what I want to do, and that I'm not fighting to get on the wall of a small underground club that, you know, that I was going to go tomorrow, the following night to, you know, do this big theater and do this special and this thing. I mean, I'm 20 years in. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? It's
yeah, that's the thing. There was a time when you would be. There was a time when you're starting out where it was like, right, in New York, when you're like, oh, man, how do I get to be that? And now that you've done it, that is gratitude is the right place to be.
For sure. I think if you're a motivated person, or you're a person who has – you know, who wants to, I want to eat the world, you know what I mean? And so, like,
yeah,
I think, like, it's easy to be like, fuck, I'm not, you know, what, I'm only playing this year, this special's not getting the, whatever it is that you inherently do to yourself that both, like, motivates you, but also kind of eats you alive.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
If you let the Statham voice, you know, like, take too much power, then you're not able to step back and have a little gratitude for what we all have gone through, which is we're all at some point trying to get on the wall of some club or trying to get booked on a, you know, the, you know, when I started in New York, it was like, invite them up, like Eugene Merman and Bobby Tisdale show or getting to go do a spot at Gotham or whatever it was that, like, those things that felt monumental. It's all the same feeling, just at different levels, but it's the same feeling of like, am I included? Am I accepted?
Yeah.
Am I celebrated? Whether it's like getting your own Netflix special or getting a late night spot, it's just like you're getting, it's signifiers of accomplishment that, you know, that mm-hmm. that we're fighting for, you know, and
you
have to be able to take a step back and be like, wow, this is happening in a way that I'm grateful for, you know?
Yeah.
Right. But then that vulnerability is the thing that also makes your work really good.
Mm-hmm.
And it makes you, like, you feel like, oh, am I good enough? Like that thing that you felt when you were young, you just don't completely shake. You constantly feel like, is this going to be all right? Is this going to be okay? And that only comes if you are really putting yourself out there and really mining something and trying to deliver with something better than when you did before.
Totally.
This special is fun. It really is so fun, Nick. You should be very proud. It's so much fun to watch. It's just the set design, you look great. It just, the material, the writing is so fucking good. It's really, really a joy to watch. You should be very proud and relieved. I know that it'll last for like 5 minutes.
Yeah.
You'll be proud for 5 minutes. You know,
but one hurdle.
But it is. It's a huge accomplishment. I mean, you've done so much. But having that hour, I feel like, is such a feather in a comedian's cap. It's so, if anything, it's so important for yourself to have done that.
Yes, that's really what I mean. A lot of this it's a lot of it is sort of for oneself. You know, it's like I want to set my mind to do something and do it, and you know, and if I can write a beautiful joke about various jokes about shitting my pants, then you know,
you did it. You did it.
Fettuccine Alfredo.
Yeah, I'm here for it.
It's so good.
Thank you.
Well, thanks, Nick, for spending some time with us. This is really, we really look forward to seeing you every time you come on. And yeah, congratulations.
You did it.
Thank you, guys.
You killed it. And, you crushed.
It means a lot coming from you guys. It's that's always the highest praise, is getting the feedback from the other comics. So I appreciate it.